Chapter 12. Orson Vane was taking lunch with Professor Van Leef. Jeanette, learning of Vane's coming, has absented herself. It is true, Vane was saying, that I can assert what no other man has asserted before, comma, that I know the exact mental machinery of two human beings. Yes, that is quite true. But, I promised nothing more, remarked Van Leef. No. That is true, too. I have lived the lives of others, I have given their thoughts a dwelling. But I am none the happier for that. Oh, admitted Van Leef, wisdom does not guarantee happiness. He drummed with his fine, long fingers, upon the tablecloth. Vane, watching him, noted the almost transparent quality of his skin. Under that admirable mask of military uprightness there was an aging, a fading process going on, that no keen observer could miss. It is the pursuit, not the capture, of wisdom, that brings happiness. Wisdom is too often only a bubble that bursts when you touch it. Perhaps that is it. At any rate, I know that I do not love my neighbor any more because I have fathomed some of his thoughts. Moreover, Professor, has it occurred to you that your discovery, your secret, carries elements of danger with it? Take my own experiments, there might have been tragic results. Whole lives might have been ruined. In one case I was nearly the victim of a tragedy myself. I might have become, for all time, the dreadful creature I was giving house room to. In the other, there was no more than a farce possible. The visiting spirit was, after all, in subjection to my own. I think you will have to simplify the details of your marvelous secret. It works a little clumsily, a little, oh, the professor put in. I am perfecting the process. I spend my days and my nights in elaborating the details. I mean to have it in the simplest, most unmistakable perfection before I hand it over to the human race. Sometimes I think, mused Vane, that your boon will be a doubtful one. I can see no good to be gained. My whole point of view is changing. I ached for such a chance of wisdom once. Now that it has come to me, I am sad because the things I have learned are so horrible, so silly. I had not thought there were such souls in the world, or not, at any rate, in the immediate world about me. Oh, the professor went on, steadfastly, there will be many benefits in the plan. Doctors will be able to go at once to the root of any ailments that have their seat in the brain. Witnesses can be made to testify the truth. Oh, there are ever so many possibilities. As many for evil as for good. Second-rate artists could steal the ideas, the inventions of others. No inventor, no scientist, would be sure of keeping his secrets. The thing would be a weapon in the hands of the unscrupulous. Ah, well, smiled Van Leef, so far I have not made my discovery public, have I? It is a thing I must consider very carefully. As you say, there are arguments on either side. But you must bear in mind that you are somewhat embittered. It was your own fault, you chose the subject wittingly. If you were to read a really beautiful mind, you might turn to the other extreme, you might urge me to lose no time in giving the world my secret. The wise way is between the two. I must go forward with my plans, prepared for either course. I may take it to my grave with me, or I may give it to the world. But, so far, it is still a little incomplete, it is not ripe for general distribution. Instead of the one magic mirror there must be myriads of them. There are stupendous opportunities. All that you have told me of your own experiences in these experiments has proved my skill to have been wisely employed. Your success was beyond my hopes. Do you think you will go on? Orson Vane did not answer at once. It was something he had been asking himself. He was not yet sure of the answer. I haven't made up my mind, he replied. So far I have hardly been repaid for my time and the vital force employed. I almost feel toward these experiments as toward a vice that refines the mind while coarsening the frame. That is the story of the most terrible vices, I think, they corrode the body while gilding the brain. But this much I know. If I use your mirror again it will not be to borrow a merely smart soul, I mean to go to some other sphere of life. That one is too contracted. Strange, said the professor, That you should have said that. Jeanette pretends she thinks that, too. I cannot get her to take her proper position in the world. She is a little elusive. But then, to be sure, she is not, just now, at her best. She is not ill? Asked Vane, with a guilty start. Nothing tangible. But not herself. Vane observed that he wished he might have found her in. He feared he had offended her. He hoped the professor would use his kind offices again to soften the young lady's feelings towards him. Then he got up to go. Strolling along the avenue, he noted certain aspects of the town with an appreciation that he had not always given them. He had seen these things from so many other points of view of late, had been in sympathy with them, had made up a fraction of their more grotesque element, that to see them clearly with his own eyes had a sort of novelty. The life of today, as it appeared on the smartest surfaces, was, he reflected, a colorful if somewhat soulless picture. The young men sit in the clubs and in the summer casinos, smoking and wondering what the new mode in trousers is to be. An acquaintance goes by, he has a hat that is not quite correct, and his friends comment on it yawningly. He has not the faintest notion of polite English, but nobody cares. A man who has written great things walks by, but he wears a creased coat, and the young men in the smoking room sniff at him. In the drags and the yachts, the women and the girls sit in radiance and gay colors and arrogant unconsciousness of position and power. They talk of golfing and fashion and mustachios. Mrs. Blank is going a hot pace and Mrs. Lanthus is a thoroughbred. Adjectives in the newest sporting slang fly about blindingly. The language is a curious argot, as distinct as the tortuous lingo of the Bowery. A coach goes rattling by, the horses throwing their heads in air, and their feet longing for the Westchester roads. The whip discusses bull terriers. The people behind him are declaring that the only thing you can possibly find in the Waldorf rooms is an impossible lot of people. The complexions of all these people, intellectually presentable in many ways, and fashionable in yet more modes, are high in health. They look happy, prosperous and satisfied. Yes, there was a superficial fairness to the picture, Vane admitted. If only, he had not chosen to look under the surface. Now that he had seen the world with other eyes, its fairness could rarely seem the same to him. A sturdy beggar approached him, with a whine that proved him an admirable actor. But Vane could not find it in him to reflect that if there is one thing more than another that lends distinction to a town, it is an abundance of beggars. He wondered how it would be to annex this healthy impostor's mite of a soul. But no, there could be little wisdom gained there. He made, finally, for the town and country club, and tried to immerse himself in the conversation that sped about. The talk turned to the eminent actor, Arthur Wantage. The subject of that man's alleged eccentricities invariably brought out a flood of the town's stalest anecdotes. Vane, listening in a lazy mood, made up his mind to see Wantage play that night. It would be a distraction. It would show him, once again, the present limit in one human being's portraiture of another. He would see the highest point to which external limitation could be brought. He could contrast it with the heights to which he himself had ascended. It would be a chance for him to consider Wantage, for the first time in his life, as a merely second-rate actor. This player was an adept only in the making the shell, the husk, seem lifelike. Since he could not read the character, how could he go deeper? The opportunities the theatre held for him suddenly loomed vast before Vane.